your money maker like somebody bought a player. I see you on my radar, don't you act like you afraid of shit.
You know I got it, if you wanna come get it, stand next to this money like, hey.
All right, guys. We're back.
We're back.
With another gripping episode of Where's My Latte?
For those of you who are curious about that music, that is Ludacris. He's an ancient...
Songbird of a generation.
He's an ancient man from the lost city of Atlanta. He's a good guy. Or not. I don't know much about God. Him. Maybe he's all right. Anyways, so this is all about America's moneymaker, which is industry.
Yep. We're going to do it. We're going to get right on into how we become... the big booming industrial supremacy.
And if you think back to our last unit, which was farmers, at the end of it, it was really like small farmers versus corporate farms called bonanza farms. So that's bonanzas. What we're picking up. Yep. All right. Little guy versus big guy. Now let's go back to the industries. Here we go. Boom.
So, oh, are we covering
pictures?
Things
way up? Too big. Whoopsies. That's all right. We wanted you to see those oil rigs or whatever they are.
Yeah. Oil drills.
Drills.
Rigs are in the ocean.
Yes.
There was someone that came up with an oil drill during this time period. It's fine. Just once again, us not...
Seems like something you should know.
Doing our research.
You're going to bring it up.
Before we get into it. So the rise of the industry that we have is going to be because of several factors. Because, I mean, obviously we had... factories like textile mills and stuff like that, but we didn't have what we have now. This
what
is where we
now conceive of as factories.
Yeah. I don't know if you were thinking about our modern factories as how it was back in the 1800s, but it really wasn't. So sorry if I led you astray at all. But we see these big, crazy industries start to grow because of several things. New technologies being one of them. New steel production techniques. Big SFI that you need to know, the Bessemer process.
B-E-S-S-E-M-E-R. Capital B, by the way.
Capital B, yes, because of someone's last name. And also, that's a proper noun. The Bessemer process was a faster, cheaper, easier way to produce steel. We could produce steel before. Now we can do it very rapidly. And so we do. Henry Bessemer came up with it. He was an immigrant from England. Turns out I didn't know where he was from. I thought he was from Ireland.
You're like 0 for 2 so
I know. I thought he was from Ireland this whole time. But we'll see a man by the name of Carnegie really corner that steel market a little bit later on.
Carnegie will corner the corporation of steel. We also see the rise of the petroleum industry. This is oil.
Better known as oil.
Yeah, better known as oil. Petroleum.
Who calls it petroleum?
That sounds weird. Like petroleum, like jolly. Like
petrol.
Yeah, petrol.
That's what it reminded me of.
It's oil, though. So we start to see the rise of that. We're going to get some big names pretty soon with that. But here's the deal. With the rise of these technologies, where America is going to start making all kinds of money moves. It turns out that the best place to do research and development is actually within the corporations themselves. Mm-hmm. It's the most effective, it's cost effective for them, and this means that it's moving away from the government. Mm-hmm.
It's how we do things.
The government is really just not going to be a part of it. We'll get back to that eventually. But
that's like a big running theme of this entire Unit 6A and 6B is we're moving away from the government doing a lot of things.
Well, and that's very laissez-faire. That's very in keeping with it.
The whole point.
Yeah, love it. All right.
So we got more stuff going on. All right.
So the rise of all these industries, well, the rise of it is really interesting. You're not going to get test questions. You might get a question on the Bessemer process, but you're not going to get...
see Bessemer process for the show.
You're not going to get questions on, like, talk to me about the steel industry in a 4-page essay. You're not going to get that. Instead, what you're going to get is how does the surrounding community deal with the rise of industry. Yeah. So here we go.
Taylorism. I've ever been sitting and then you hear a bell and you take a break and then you hear another bell and you sit down.
Is that school?
Is that what we do here?
Sounds like it.
That's Taylorism for you.
All right. Taylorism, named after a guy, Frederick Taylor. He is interested in making sure that production occurs efficiently, with the highest value, and the most safety. So how do we reduce the number of steps? So if Ms. Knowles and I are both here and we're making a shoe, okay, a very practical shoe for work, they would use photography, ding, ding, ding. We actually have studied this in art history, for those of you that remember Edward Muybridge and Horse Galloping, where it's stop motion photography, and we basically take like rapid succession images of people, in this case with Muybridge, of a horse running, but with Taylorism, of people working. And we basically compare the steps people take in their production. When we do that, we can start to see like, oh, Ms. Collazo is doing three more steps, but resulting in the same product. So what we need to do is start to reduce the number of steps that Collazo is doing to increase her productivity. But it's also about safety. The upside is you get a cheaper product because it's being produced more quickly. The downside is that it starts to eliminate jobs because
it
add three steps up over 5,000 people.
Right.
You don't need a bunch of them. So part of this is because of assembly line, the movable, apparently, assembly line.
versus a non-moving assembly line, which I'm not really sure about.
Yeah, so Henry Ford.
we're really cooking right now.
Guys, it's the first day. It's teacher planning day.
We're so good at this.
January 4th. You guys are still relaxing. So Henry Ford doing the assembly line with the production of his cars. Mm-hmm. More to come on him a little bit later.
And then the success of that leads other industries to do it. Like Taylorism, because it is so efficient, people start losing jobs, things do get sold cheaper, and so that's okay. I mean, it's not good that people lose jobs.
Well, it's not okay. All right.
It's not okay.
We'll get into that, though. So
we'll
the corporation.
Coming back.
So we start to see these guys like Henry Ford, many, many more. It's, I think they're on one of our other slides, but we see Rockefeller, Carnegie. Don't worry about their names because you'll see them on a slide or two. But they start creating these monopolies. And monopolies are not illegal until the year 1890. And in the year 1890, we have something called the Sherman Antitrust Act, which we will come back to. So a monopoly is basically, you guys have played the game, it's when you own everything.
Yeah.
You have to own something like 90% of the production or more.
Of a market.
Of a market or more to be considered a monopoly. And at this point, it's not illegal to do. You just, do it.
It's all about like tactics and just like already having nice things and, or not nice things, but money. Which I mean, I guess you could own nice things too, but it's all about like basically shutting everybody else down so that you can be the best.
You got to corner that market. Now, what we also start to see is that because we've got these guys running these companies, we've got board of trustees that we'll talk about in a minute, they can't do the everyday, day-to-day getting into the factory. So we start to see the development of middle management. Mm-hmm. And this, for me, is very much Michael from The Office.
Yes.
All right.
Branch manager. I was just going to say branch manager.
Yeah.
That's middle management.
That's middle management. They get paid more.
VPs would, I guess, be a little bit like, if you're in charge of an entire corporation, you are never going to interact with the people that are at the bottom. You're going to have steps. And so this was just born out of the creation of monopolies.
Because
so,
they're getting so big.
So big.
We need people that can do the day-to-day work. All right. Mm-hmm. So. We also see, look at those railroads. We got so many.
Major expansion of railroads. We already talked about that when we talked about the West, because most of the expansion will be into the West. But this is a big source of industrial growth because it
not only actually materials to build the railroads.
Right. But new markets.
Yeah, the railroads also facilitate the expansion of markets and therefore the increase in the number of products. Like mail order stuff starts to become very popular.
Catalogs. You what was guys, it, Montgomery Ward or Sears?
Both. cool. I mean, you guys like Amazon. I like Amazon.
Love me some Amazon.
Get me some Amazon Prime, two-day delivery. Yeah, and so this is sort of the beginning of that.
Yeah. Catalog businesses, opening up new markets. Also, as the railroads increase, then the demand for the products are going to increase, so the corporations back in the East are going to increase. And it's very much cyclical. Like, we have all this steel. Let's expand the railroad. Now we're expanding more. We need more steel.
Right.
So we cycle through those things like that. Also, because of the growth of the railroad, time zones.
Time zones. Because if you don't have time zones and you say, I'm showing up at noon, nobody knows when noon is.
You ain't getting there at noon.
So people showing up at, 2 in the afternoon, but it's noon. Anyways, you get it. So you know what time zones are. We need some level of consistency, and this is where it starts.
Yep.
So there you go. All right.
Moving on. Okay. Here's where we really get into more of the monopolistic style of things is consolidation.
Such a fancy word, monopolistic.
I know. I was trying to recoup for when I said
I feel that
I didn't know what the oil rig was called. So we're consolidating power and we're consolidating businesses. There's two types of consolidation. I guess horizontal is more consolidate-y than vertical, yeah, in my opinion.
I agree.
There's horizontal and there's vertical. What we're really going to see when we talk about Sherman Antitrust is horizontal, and that's what is still illegal today. But horizontal is you own one company and you buy out other companies that do the same thing that you do.
Yeah, and vertical integration, it comes from Andrew Carnegie, who says to pay nobody profit. Mm-hmm. So basically, you just start adding not just the production, mm-hmm, but shipping, packaging, advertising, all into one corporation. But we're going to talk about this a lot in class.
Yeah.
Because Ms. Knowles and I both really like to chat up about this one.
Economics, that's my jam.
I just like to talk about like the production of like cookies and cheese and whatever you guys want.
Snacks and chats.
Yeah, snacks and chats. Oh, it's a perfect snack.
Perfect.
All right. So the Robert Baron, the Robber Baron.
It's
not how you say it at all. It's called the Robber Baron. Robber Baron, it's a nasty term.
Yes.
But
a robber is not a
robber.
I also feel like robber, I would never call them a robber. I'd call them a thief. But anyway, but that's not good if you are a robber or a thief. And so they're like taking money basically from other people or taking business from other people.
Yeah. And think about a baron, like back in the day, like land ownership, and like you would be a baron of a property and have people, your serfs working on the land. Mm-hmm. So basically we say robber baron to mean a late 19th century corporate owner.
Captain of industry.
Yeah.
You can see them called robber barons, which is negative, or you can think of them as captains of industry, which are like...
They sound very like Avengers.
Yes.
You know? So we just gave you some names here. Rockefeller, this is going to be for Standard Oil Company. Mm-hmm. Henry Frick, who is going to be along with Carnegie with the steel industry. Mm-hmm. Vanderbilt, who does a lot of railroads.
Big railroad
big
guy.
Big railroads. Flagler, who also does a railroad. There's an extra comma there I forgot to erase. But we could add people. J.P. Morgan.
J.P. Morgan.
Who does banking. Frick. Not Frick. Flagler, for a very short time, does salt, which is a big old failure.
Okay.
It does. He almost goes bankrupt.
Would we throw... GE. Who's in charge of that? Edison? Would we throw Edison in there?
I wouldn't.
Really?
Mm-mm.
Ooh, because of Westinghouse?
Mm-hmm. Ugh. Guys.
Love me some light bulb conversations.
AC/DC. Get into it.
Get into it.
That's when they electrocuted that elephant.
Uh-huh.
That was awful.
They electrocuted a lot of people in the late 1800s, but...
Just to see how it
worked. But by accident.
Jeez. I don't know why she's laughing, kids. This is a sad discussion. She's a nervous laugher. All right. So all these guys are basic... People look at them. Many people look at them as like, oh, Rockefeller, you're like making like billions of dollars.
Mm-hmm.
Like, but your workers are super, super poor.
Yeah. They're like hoarding it all up at the top.
You know, and Rockefeller attempts to kind of calm that sort of view by giving back to the community and becoming a philanthropist. You guys may have heard of Rockefeller Center, not actually a philanthropic adventure necessarily.
No.
but that we have the Carnegie Institute,
Vanderbilt
Carnegie
University, Flagler University.
So we do, they do give back quite a bit of money. And so,
it's only because they have to. So they don't.
Well,
look back.
Do they have to though? Because I would say this, Rockefeller is very concerned. While I may discuss, he's very concerned about his children becoming entitled.
Oh, yeah.
He was really
concerned
is.
About that.
And so this man who is worth millions upon millions upon billions of dollars gives away like 95% of his wealth at his death.
A la Bill Gates.
Yeah.
His kids ain't getting nothing.
My
well,
kid,
a lot,
Jackie
but...
Chan, did the same thing. He's like,
Jackie Chan did do that.
I'll help you get an education, but guess what?
Jackie Chan, not a business owner.
Daddy made this money.
You ain't getting nothing.
So you better pack up that fragile masculinity and get to getting out there. Not raising a little kid in the corner who just sits in the front of this teacher's class. And
Alexis Rose.
Alexis Rose. Stop it. She's the best.
I love her.
But she's part of this.
She is. She was not a Rockefeller.
Not Rockefeller would have been like, not gonna happen. Get a job.
Get it together.
Get a job. So anyway, I digress. There is certainly, Rockefeller does try to give back quite a bit, mm-hmm. but also, you know who he could have given back to? His workers.
Yeah, whatevs.
He didn't, though.
He built ice skating rinks.
Yeah, also he was like, I'm going to give away 95% of my wealth. But guess what? 5% of a quadrillion dollars is significant.
Pretty hefty, yeah.
So, Rockefeller, way to ruin America. I'm kidding. He helped to, he's a captain of industry.
It's fine.
He's got a cape.
He does have a cape. Okay, trust.
Moving right along. I don't really know what any of that was about, kids. But let's go on to trust.
Trust in the holding company.
Guess what? Monopolies, illegal, 1890. Here we go. Write it down, kids.
This is where it happens. Sherman Antitrust Act.
Anti-Trust Act.
There was a very, light push to try and, hear people out and say, okay, yeah, maybe monopolies, not great. But it wasn't the vertically integrated companies. It was only the horizontally integrated companies. It was trusts. And we still have, even the Sherman Antitrust Act was very vague. Lots of loopholes. We had to fix it later.
So basically,
wasn't that Wilson?
Yeah, the whole reason that we have a Sherman Antitrust Act is that you don't want an economy in America that you have five or six people in charge of.
Right.
It's very dangerous. We want to be able to diversify a bit more than that. And so it's a way to try to protect that. And the basic condition
of the Sherman... We're supposed to have a mixed economy here. Yeah. Where it's not going to be all one way, like socialism and not all another way, like 100%. We're supposed to be mixed, right. Where we have a little bit of say from the government. We have a little bit of say from the people, but it works together. So we use the Sherman Antitrust Act kind of just to say we still want this.
Right, and it just says that it forbids the restraint of trade. That's really the quote you need. It forbids the restraint of trade. And the idea with the Sherman Antitrust Act is that if you've got Rockefeller with the Standard Oil Company that's got 95% of the oil business cornered, he is therefore restraining trade by eliminating other businesses.
Right, and now he dictates everything about the 5% too.
So
then you can't charge whatever you want if you're part of the 5% because everyone's going to be like, okay, well, Rockefeller's cheaper, so I'm going to go buy gas from him.
Right. So this leads to the development of trust and holding companies in the business world. It's a way to get around the Sherman Antitrust Act. It's a way to be like, technically, we're not a monopoly.
I don't own everything, I'm not a monopolistic person.
So a trust is created by a holding company. A holding company is basically a board of trustees that buy up so much stock that they own the corporation technically and make all the decisions. Rockefeller won't make the decisions. Side note, of course he does.
Yeah, he does.
He's got all these guys' cell phone numbers. The holding company, the board of trustees, will make the decisions for the company, but they also share the profits of the company. Mm-hmm. So it's a monopoly.
It's still a monopoly.
It just, arose by any other name.
Right.
Situation.
True.
Well, look at that.
Wow.
Sprinkled in there.
Got some little Shakespeare action happening. We still have trust hearings and issues today.
Sure.
I feel like...
cell phone companies get into this a lot.
Cell phone companies get...
Microsoft Apple.
Had 95, 96, Microsoft had a big deal. Apple had a big deal. Bill Gates was belligerent in that hearing for him. He was like, you don't know what you're talking about. I just watched the special on the 90s.
Wow.
Such a loser.
All right. So... Sherman Antitrust, trying to get around it.
Mm-hmm.
And then at the end of the day, we're like, why are we fighting this, man?
Yeah.
These guys, Rockefeller owns all of this because he's a friggin' genius.
Right. I'm not going to be able to control it. Might as well let him do it.
Yeah. Johnny, you want to be super rich like that?
Johnny D, you got this.
Do it. Show up. And I think that in America, we definitely, listen, I even have that where it's like, if I wanted to... quit my job and start that Etsy shop, you could do it.
Miss Collazo talks constantly about her Etsy shop that you actually have an
Etsy. I actually have an Etsy shop, guys.
It's empty.
I have zero sales.
But
there's nothing there, but I did reserve the site. Okay. For one day. But guess what, guys? I don't know that day's ever going to come. I don't know if I'm one of these self-made people. And part of it is because it's a myth, but it's an American myth.
Yeah. It's part of our identity.
It's part of our identity.
Boop, boop, boop theme, National American Identity.
We always believe that we can do it. And I think that's such a wonderful part of being American, mm-hmm. but it also can be a little bit dangerous sometimes.
Yeah.
Because it's constantly making you feel like a failure.
Right. Because no one really actually is a self-made man.
It's really tough. There may be a few out there for sure. I'm not going to say that. I mean, Carnegie is a self-made man.
Right.
But Carnegie's Scottish.
Yeah. Scottish. Not Irish. Yeah. I don't know where anyone's from.
You don't, but that's all right. I feel like everybody's from Massachusetts, so it doesn't really matter. So the myth of the self-made man is basically that it doesn't matter. Don't let anybody tell you that your station in life, your ethnic background, your religious affiliation, your gender, your anything. Don't let anyone tell you that those things can stop you from... And guys, it's a really warm and fuzzy feeling, mm-hmm. but you got to look at the nuts and bolts of it. Are these people really self-made? Andrew Carnegie, I'm going to agree. For sure he is. He mm-hmm. comes over. He lived in back in Scotland. He was broke. He lived in a tiny little, like, hard to even call it a house. Came mm-hmm. to the United States, I think, alone. I think they just put him on a boat and, like, kicked him out.
Ta-ta.
And he started in the mailroom of a corporation, and mm-hmm. then he owned it. I mean, this guy, you can't mess with that. There are people out there that are like that, right?
And that is... few and far between.
It's few and far between. It exists, but it's few and far between.
Right.
Right? More likely what's happening is that these people are coming from very wealthy families.
Most of these captains of industry were at the top already, and they just got bigger.
Yeah. I mean, think about Flagler, who goes into a business of salt, almost goes bankrupt, tries to take a little bit of, he worked with Rockefeller for a while, tried to take some of Rockefeller's business and start his own corporation. That didn't work. How many people can come back from two bankruptcies?
And how do you do that? With help.
Because you already have help.
Yeah.
You already have that foot in the door. Now, that's just much more common. And that's why it's called the myth of the self-made man.
Mm-hmm.
But the people who are coming through the ranks, the people who are these big titans of industry, what we start to see is like a way to not, I don't want to say it's an excuse. It's not that. But mm-hmm. it's an explanation.
Right.
For why they're on top. Like this. And we call it social Darwinism.
It's just survival of the fittest, but in business. Like, sorry that you suck, but you need someone stronger mentally to do this, and you ain't doing it.
Yeah. So Darwinism, y'all know, is survival of the fittest, like she said, and we just apply the term social to it to say, well, now we're going to use that idea of Darwinism, not in terms of animals and development and all of that.
But to explain your place in society.
Yeah, social issues.
Yeah.
Industry, economy. People, immigrants.
In the world, yeah.
Yeah. Why does this person continually fail at their attempt to do something? It's because they're not as strong is the explanation. But I like to think of what Einstein said, which is if you have to teach a fish to climb a tree, everybody's going to look like an idiot, right? Mm-hmm. We all have our skills. That's your warm and fuzzy of the day. You're not a failure. You just haven't found your niche.
You just
got
to find your niche.
You got to find it. All right?
That's fine.
but social Darwinism became a way of excusing... the situation, the economic disparities in the United States
because
at the time.
We did have major economic disparities, and I feel like that's going to be when we talk about the city and that is. But we have like nothing in the middle. You're either like mad poor or you're mad rich.
Yeah, and this is really why Mark Twain deems this the Gilded Age. Because on the outside, man, we look like we are rock mm-hmm. money maker everywhere.
Right.
But it turns out. That's like such a small, that's like the 1%.
And it's that shiny top layer that attracts a lot of people to the United States too. Like, look at all the wealth. Like, that's what gilded is. Sorry, but I'm pretty sure that these guys aren't solid gold on your desk right now.
She's talking about my file cabinets that are clearly solid gold. I don't buy anything less than that.
She's rich. She's got her Etsy shop.
I have an Etsy shop and I'm a teacher. Solid gold.
Rolling in dough.
All right.
Oh, look at that line. So much stuff.
Yeah, so this really isn't that long of a slide.
No.
so Gospel of Wealth, first of all, this is, we sort of talked about it with Rockefeller, but this is Carnegie.
Yeah.
Carnegie writes this whole thing about like, guys, I got you. God made me super wealthy, but with that wealth comes responsibility.
With great power comes great responsibility.
So he starts giving
Spider-Man.
Back.
Right.
He starts giving back. He starts saying like, I know that I have a lot of money, but I'll give back to the communities. We'll mm-hmm. do community centers. We'll do all these little things.
Not my workers.
Not your workers.
The community.
They'll get help through my community centers, but I'm not going to pay them more.
Mm-hmm.
And so that's Carnegie's whole idea. And you should definitely connect this idea with the gospel of wealth. It is a religious sentiment. There is a Christian responsibility, as far as Carnegie thinks, to give back.
That's your moral right. God gave you this wealth. God wants you to
keep going.
Pay it forward.
Keep going. Now, there are many people who, again, gospel of wealth and the self-made man and social Darwinism are kind of ways to excuse the status quo in America. But then there are also these people who are like, hold up. There's probably another version of what's happening here. So we've listed them here for you. A couple of my favorites, Thorstein Veblen. I just can't stop talking about
her. Loves her some Thorstein Veblen.
Well, and Edward Bellamy is fun. So Henry George, Progress and Poverty, you can probably explain it there.
Right. That's it.
Edward Bellamy, looking backwards, he writes a very Rip Van Winkle style story where a guy in like 1890 falls asleep and wakes up in the year like 2010, something like that. Maybe it was like 1998. I think it was 2000.
Really?
I think he wakes up in 2000. Google that.
I'm going to Google it.
And he wakes up and he looks back and he's like, oh my goodness.
Look at this society that we have.
Everybody's socialist and it's amazing, he says.
Wait, what's it called again? He called it fraternal cooperation.
Yeah. So he basically is like, in the 18th, he's able to look back at the last century and he sees an America that did not continue in this capitalist pursuit, but rather sort of switch gears and turn socialist.
It's 2000.
Thank you.
You're right. Damn.
I know me some Edward Bellamy. Yeah. So Edward Bellamy, he looks back and says like, yeah, America really took a very drastic turn. Now he gives a very positive spin on it, as most of these authors do.
Yeah.
They do lean quite socialist, which we'll continue to talk about, and we'll even talk about what that means, socialism in the future, and pretty quick actually here. Thorstein Veblen, conspicuous consumption. This is like if you drive. Like, my husband works in car sales, so I can't really knock it, right? Because he drives, like, a fancy car. But if you drive a fancy car just because you want a fancy car.
Just to flex on him.
It's a flex. That's all that is. You don't need, like, for me, a computer and a car, they are functional objects. It might as well be, like, a Flintstone car. Might as well be a typewriter. Like, I don't.
Don't care.
I'm not going to type. But.
Meanwhile, microphone. Laptop.
Gold pen with a diamond
on top. With a diamond on top.
Very bougie up in here.
So bougie.
But that it's not a bad thing being part like purchasing those things, purchasing expensive cars when cars are just functional objects, purchasing expensive clothes, expensive houses, all of those things. It's called conspicuous consumption. We are purchasing things in an obvious manner in order to show others what status we are.
If you got it, flaunt it.
If you got it, flaunt it. And it's a psychological sort of thing that we start to want to be associated with very specific social classes and economic classes. So that's conspicuous consumption. We still do it. This is a community that we do it a lot.
We do it.
We have the financial means very often to do it. And it's, again, it's not really, it's not a bad thing. It's just a psychological experiment.
Yeah.
Which, again, I got gold file folders. I'm rich.
She's so rich.
So rich.
And then we have actually one of our first little exposés here, Ida Tarbell, History of the Standard Oil Company. We're going to fall into so many more people like Ida Tarbell, where it's just like, this is just like what could be, we need to change things. Like, it's criticisms, but this is like a straight up exposé. Like, here's what's happening in the Standard Oil Company, and it ain't good.
Yeah. And we start to get themes of, competition, which everyone's telling us competition is what benefits
breeds
America.
Innovation.
And she's like, actually, cooperation in this case over competition would be more beneficial, not only to workers, but also the industry.
Mm-hmm.
But we ain't hearing that. Quiet, Ida.
Ida.
We'll come back to you.
Chill.
Chill out. All right. So, what is up with the monopolies? Because it corners markets, they're able to inflate prices. The economy, every 5 to 6 years now, we are experiencing panics. No likey. That's not good. And we are seeing an increase in the disparity between the rich and the poor. Everybody's standard of living is actually increasing.
Yeah.
Which sounds super positive, and it is, because we're starting to see cleaner cities. We'll get to that eventually. We're starting to see better healthcare systems, but we're also starting to see that great gap.
Yeah, really big gap.
Yeah, so, you know.
Do we eliminate the middle class?
It's getting there.
It's getting there.
I think it's worse now than it was then, though.
Yeah. Yes.
Side note.
That may not be true.
It's worse now than it was in the Great Depression.
Yes, it is.
This is probably much worse than now.
Yeah.
sorry, America.
Back on track.
I lied.
So, yes, the monopolies, they're what's inflating the prices, basically, and that's what's creating economic inequality. Moving on. Industrial workers in the new economy. Okay, so we've talked about how Rockefeller and Carnegie, they want to give back to community, but not within their own structures that they've created. And that begins to be an issue here. Before we get to that, though, the immigrant workforce. Major influx of immigrants from this time period. We talked about that when we talked about people moving out to the West, didn't we? As a push factor.
I don't know.
Like, it's becoming kind of crowded, and so people are...
I don't know if we've talked about that. But we have two immigrant sources that we need to sort of identify. We have the old immigrant population, and that's capital O, old.
Yeah.
Like, that's their term. Old immigrant populations are largely German and Irish. And most Americans have a little bit of one of those, if not both, in their blood. But the old immigrants who have been around for quite some time and nobody liked for it. I mean,
right.
Irish need not apply situations.
Know nothing party.
Yeah.
Yeah. We hated them until the new immigrants.
Well, and then the shift happens where now we have a new population called the new immigrants. Mm-hmm. That blows your mind. Old immigrant versus new immigrant.
Wow, crazy.
New immigrant. Listen, it's still a very large population of German and Irish coming in. That's not going to stop. But we see this boom all of a sudden of Southern and Eastern Europeans. So we're looking at Spain, Greece, Italy, Russia.
Italy big. Poland.
Poland, there we go.
I was going to be like, Slavic nations.
Estonia, but that's later. That's not yet. There's no Estonia.
There's no Estonia right now.
So.
So the older immigrants, I don't know if you said this. I kind of blanked out for a minute.
Wow, thank you.
Sorry. Well, just keep on rambling. They're much easier to assimilate.
Yeah. So,
did you say that?
Yeah. Well, I didn't say that, but it's true. So now that we have the new immigrant population, which do not look at what these white Americans
they
think
don't
they should look like.
They don't look like us. They don't talk like us. They don't dress like us. They don't cook the same foods.
They don't have the same religion as us.
They've got even Catholicism is like, oh, this is easier to accept than Orthodox.
Yeah. Not so much Italian and Spanish, obviously, definitely further east. So it becomes like, yeah, the Irish have an accent, but they speak English.
Yeah.
Except for those Gaelic people. Gaelic is crazy.
Gaelic is crazy.
But normal...
Caitlin.
Normal Irish. What does that even mean? I don't know. People from Ireland? But people who
normal
speak
Irish
English...
People.
Just with a thick Irish accent, easier to assimilate. I can understand you. I can't understand the people who are speaking like Russian. So it becomes a new barrier.
Right.
So we are more easily
really
accepting
like
the Irish, but we really don't like anyone else. Even the Irish don't like anyone else, but
right.
This is expected.
The Irish get real aggressive.
We've been following this trend, again, American identity. We've been following this trend that there always has to be somebody socially and economically below you so that you aren't the bottom.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And so now it's the new immigrants. And the tension between them is tough.
Yeah.
And the Irish treat the new immigrants just as poorly as Americans were treating the Irish. And it's just a bad situation. But what we do know is that it doesn't really matter necessarily where you're from. If you're working in a factory, you're not going to have a whole lot.
Right.
So bad pay, bad conditions, bad hours, no health care.
No
we're actually healthcare. The only industrialized nation at this point that doesn't have health care. For workers' comp, basically. So
we don't get that for a hot minute.
Yeah, we lag behind in a few of those things, and so this is certainly one of them. Women and children. Obviously, we're going to pay women less. Child labor laws are horribly ineffective and will be well into the 20th century.
Right.
I mean, we're talking 1930s and 40s.
The really poor people that are working work are going to need their children to also boost the household income, and so we have a lot of children that are working in very dangerous conditions that they shouldn't be, and we have a lot of injury, a lot of death from these, a big incident, Triangle Shirtwaist Factory fire.
Yeah.
That's horrific. Everyone dies.
Yeah.
Except for the people that managed it. What are you going to do?
Protest and get some workers'
well,
rights.
Well, we fixed that. Poorly paid women, poorly paid children, but they need whatever little money that they have because the disparity and the living conditions are so terrible.
So we start to see an attempt to unionize, which also reminds me of one of the Office episodes where the warehouse guys try to unionize and Jan says, don't do it. Jan Levinson.
Freaking cool. Jan.
So they start to unionize. Now, unions, we've actually sort of already dabbled in this when it came to farmers with the Grangers and the farmer alliances. Not technically unions, but yeah, they are. So here we see the National Labor Union, the NLU, which starts like 1876. It's really, really early. No, 1866.
66.
But it fizzles out in the 70s with a panic. They're just like, yep. Matt, let's just go
away. Panic of 73 crushed it.
There you go. We also see the Molly Maguires, who are an Irish group,
right?
Mm-hmm. Who used to, they're basically like domestic terrorists. They used to set off bombs and mines and stuff. But they were doing it to like shut down like labor mines.
Yeah.
And then they
sticking it to the man.
I also at one point read that they like would cross dress, but I think it was a la Boston Tea Party, like
I feel that
disguises and stuff.
Mm.
I don't know. No judgment.
More on that later.
So we do start to see other groups unionize, and we're going to see a thread through all of these strikes that we're coming up to about what they want. Now, all labor unions, it doesn't matter who they are. We have two different types. We have something called an industrial union, which is an unskilled labor union,
right.
And we have a craft union, which is skilled like labor. You have a craft, right?
Like you practiced to be in this industry.
Yes. So we see those two, and all of them, it doesn't matter which one they are, have something in common, and it's that at the core of what they believe in, they're fighting for what we call bread and butter issues. It's better pay, better conditions, better hours.
Mm-hmm.
So without fail, bread and butter issues are at the core of every single union.
Right. They may want some other things.
They're going to want other things.
But all of the unions want those three things 100%.
Yes. So let's talk about the game Monopoly, B&O Railroad. Real thing. So the B&O Railroad, which is the Baltimore and Ohio Railroad, you can call it B&O. All right. There is a strike that occurs, but it occurs out in like Maryland or something, right? Yeah, I feel like it's in Maryland somewhere. Baltimore. Yeah.
I thought it was somewhere more west.
Well, it goes west.
Yeah.
So I believe it starts in Baltimore, though. But double check that, kiddos. So the Baltimore and Ohio Railroad.
Everything starts Pullman again.
Everything back to Pullman. So this company cuts wages by 10%. That tends to be like the general number. Pay cut of 10%.
It's a good round number.
It's an easy round number. And people are like, nope. Nope. And they start striking. And they start tearing up train tracks. And they start burning stuff. And
people die.
People are dying. And then somebody gets on the telefono and says, hello, people out further west. Guess what we're doing? We're tearing up railroads.
We're striking.
And this becomes, it's called the Great Strike because it's national. Mm-hmm. It goes from coast to coast and it's big time. And at first, the American public is like, yeah, go on strike. And then they're like, ooh.
Wait, my stuff's not getting anywhere.
You're burning stuff. That's not appropriate.
Shut it down.
So people didn't like this whole idea of the Great Strike. It definitely gets put out in newspapers as pejorative against these strikers, that they shouldn't have gone this far.
Mm-hmm.
But more to come because it's just the first for us.
First of many.
And then we have the Knights of Labor.
The Knights of Labor, these were the mostly unskilled or all unskilled?
Well, it's industrial.
It's industrial.
So
I see. I never refer to it as craft industrial. I only refer to it as skilled and unskilled.
That's
so mean, though.
It's so, yeah.
It's very harsh. You have no skills.
Industrial. Well, and think about industrial unions as like, as an industry, as a factory. Like, we want to incorporate all people in an industry. So Knights of Labor is an industrial union that's going to incorporate people in all, like not all industries, but you'll have the Knights of Labor that has a steel factory group and then somebody else who has a textile factory group. And so they, doesn't matter what level you're at, you could be the kid who, you know, puts like threads the bobbins or something. You don't actually do that, but you could be the kid who like changes bobbins out, or you could be the person who's the manager of the textile company. It doesn't matter. You're all able to be part of that same industrial union.
Because it is an industry.
Right.
Yeah.
And that's what the Knights of Labor.
I should really stop saying skilled and unskilled then.
Yeah. Yeah.
Sorry, honors kids that already talked about this. whatever.
Next year.
Next year, I got you.
So the Knights of Labor really—that's what they do. They have great mustaches. They are like bread and butter issues. They also let women and African Americans join the ranks, which
a big is very one of their big pushes outside of the bread and butter was to end child labor.
In child labor,
because that was mostly industrial.
Mm-hmm.
You weren't a skilled child working in a craft industry.
No.
Sorry, kids.
They also lean socialist.
Yes.
The Knights of Labor, which...
they wanted to reform the economy in general.
They did. They didn't like capitalism. And so while we talk about organizations, they all believe in bread and butter, the Knights of Labor also believe in economic reform. And so when we look at things like strikes, and it's one of my favorite things to talk about, so pardon, but the Knights of Labor did not like strikes. They will strike, but it's a last-ditch effort. They want boycotts.
Yeah.
Because their belief is that if they... if they go on strike, what they're advocating for is if you go on strike, you're basically going to be resolved through a wage increase. If you accept a wage increase, you're accepting capitalism.
Right.
So you don't want to accept that.
Getting paid by the man.
Right. You're still getting paid by the man. You're still getting paid hourly, which means we've put a value on you as an individual per hour. And that's not what they want. They don't last that long.
No.
But they are the most... like all-inclusive.
Yes, that's a good thing.
And it says a dissolution of the Knights of Labor, but I feel like we got to talk about that in a minute.
Yeah, after.
But this is one reason people don't like the Knights of Labor. It's because, whoa, you want to change America?
Radical, bye.
Too radical for us, leave.
We don't like those ideas. The AFL. This is the craft.
Yes.
They are skilled.
Craft unit.
So a little different. They are not letting everyone in.
No.
They don't like female employment. They also don't like immigrant employment, right? No, they do.
Yeah, they're fine with it. I mean, most of them are. Because the craft typically comes from, like, old school European crafting.
And whittling Samuel chairs. Samuel Gompers was an immigrant, wasn't he?
Samuel Gompers, I believe he was an immigrant. He was a cigar roller.
Yes, he was a cigar roller. That was his craft.
And here, I always liken it to, like, when you're part of the senior class, it's easier for you to get privileges as a member of the senior class if it's just the seniors. If everybody asks for rights, it's like,
what a good analogy.
Yeah, I know. I'm just on it. So the AFL's like, unskilled laborers, you can't be part of our group because we have more clout than you. So back up. Also, AFL only wants bread and butter.
Right.
No, they like capitalism because they're at the top of it as far as workers.
That's true.
So...
That's the top agenda. Of the lower class.
The top of the bottom.
Upper, lower class. Yes. That's their agenda. They're okay with capitalism. They really wanted that 8-hour workday.
Yeah, they're into it.
That was their like head bread and butter issue. And then the Haymarket Square riot affair, if you will. It doesn't have anything to do with the AFL, really. It's like blamed on the AFL, I guess. It started out as a celebration.
Yeah, so there's this thing called May Day. That's celebrated in Europe. It's not really celebrated here in America. And by that, I mean it's not. But for a hot minute, people wanted to celebrate it here. It's basically a Labor Day. It's a celebration of workers. That's what May Day is.
We're like, we're not going to take your European Labor Day. We'll create our own Labor Day.
We don't want it. We'll do it in September. So on May 1st in Europe, I got to experience this when I was in Greece one time. And there's a maypole that everybody dances around with ribbons. It's very exciting.
Very exciting.
But basically, we were going to have a May Day celebration in America. And this means that it's mainly immigrants that are celebrating this.
Because it is European.
Because it's European. And the AFL was, like we said, a big advocate of the 8-hour workday. And so because May Day was coming up, people were like, let's do our let's do our May Day party, but also we should be asking for 8-hour workday. Thanks so much, AFL. So in Chicago, in Haymarket Square, some people started doing the celebration / protest for an 8-hour workday.
And then violence broke out.
Yeah. So long story short, we can probably get more into it in class, but there's some back and forth violence between police and some no-named individuals in the crowd. A bomb is thrown. Some shots are fired.
It's all very anonymous, but we blame it on...
We blame it on, I think it's like 8 German immigrants.
Mm-hmm.
And then they were like, oh, you're German. You're probably parts of the Knights of Labor, which is also majority German. Mm-hmm. Even though the Knights of Labor had zero to do with this. They did not advocate for it. They did not tell people to show up. Actually, they may have told them a little bit. But it wasn't like a sponsored event.
We're not going to tell you to not show up.
Right. But it leads to the decline of the Knights of Labor. Mm-hmm. Because they're like, you guys are too radical for us. So that's the significance of the Haymarket affair. And then, like, most of the people are jailed. One guy kills himself in jail, and, like, two are executed, I think. I could be making all that up, though. That's kind of a theme in this podcast. Let's just make it up. All right.
What's real? What's not?
You'll never know.
It's a myth.
So two more big strikes for us. Again, try to do this really quickly for you. Homestead strike. This is in Pennsylvania.
Mm-hmm.
Homestead, Pennsylvania.
This is the last sign, I think. It is in Pennsylvania because it is Steel, Pittsburgh, Steelers.
Homestead.
Homestead strike.
So,
Frick.
Andrew Carnegie
okay.
is in charge of the Homestead plant, and they have a union that works for them. It's called the Amalgamated Steel, Iron, and blah, blah, blah.
Amalgamated Associated Steel and Iron Workers.
There you go. They're just called the Amalgamated, which means mixed. So they're mixed iron workers, like steel and iron and
steel
all that.
Steel and iron.
So, Carnegie is in charge. He owns the company, right? Mm-hmm. It's a Carnegie Steel Company. And he is like, oh, man, wouldn't it be really great if we could cancel this union contract we have with these workers and just hire all the, like, new cheap labor coming in that don't have unions? Frick, I'm going to go on vacation to Scotland indefinitely. You handle it.
Frick, bye. I'm out of here.
So Frick does. And so Frick is like, oh, we'll just start making decisions without going to the union.
Right.
And that's illegal because if you have contracts with unions, you have to do something called...
Collectively bargain.
Collectively bargain.
I was like, what?
Collective bargaining. Collective bargaining is a right when you're part of a union.
When you're a part of a union, you get to collectively bargain. That's your right. You have to. You get to be represented as a worker.
Business negotiations.
At negotiations. And but, Frick was just like, next?
Right. And that's the thing. Like, Frick didn't have to do it.
Right.
And except they had a contract with this union. So he just starts ignoring them and shutting them out and all that stuff. And so the strikers are like, yep, we're going to strike then.
All right. And strike.
And it's actually a lockout. No, it's not. Not a lockout. What's it called? Anyways, forget it, kids. It's just called a strike.
Pinkerton's winning. I know that.
Yeah.
I can't find it on here.
But. Frick is going to build basically a big barrier called Fort Frick. He builds a huge fence around the factory so people can continue to work. And all of these kicked out union workers now are just hanging out like on the Allegheny River and just sitting doing their thing. And then the Pinkertons, who are an anti-immigrant security force, come on sailing down the river and open fire on them. And like, ba-bing. I mean, it happens all again.
Right.
And eventually the union is going to be defeated, but people were like, was it really necessary to start shooting at them, Pinkertons?
Yes.
So public opinion is very important when it comes to unions.
Emma Goldman wrote a piece on it.
Done.
Emma Goldman. The union defeated, it was because the union members were not the only ones, I mean, it, not just because of this, but they weren't the only ones that worked at the factory. And so, like, day-to-day operations of the factory could continue on without these union members. Like, it's not worth it to boycott or strike if things are still happening. That's why a lot of tactics of corporations and businesses against labor unions included temporary workers.
Yeah.
Scabs, if you will.
Scabs.
Yeah, scabs that would come in and just, like, yeah, your keep strike working. Is now, like, moot because...
I'm going to keep working for
we're
you.
We're going to keep working. Done.
Consider it a long-term substitute.
Yeah.
That's all that is. Look at that. Bringing it back to education.
Ran right on home.
Now, side note, interesting story about Mr. Henry Frick. There was an assassination attempt on him at this point.
A
Russian immigrant comes in and stabs him and shoots him, I believe. Stabs him in the neck a couple times.
So it wasn't an attempt or was he actually assassinated?
No. He goes to the hospital. They like sew him up. Frick gets back to work.
Your neck's fine. Get back
here. Your neck is intact, sir. Baby. Get back to work.
Get back to work.
Now, the guy who did it, whose name, I want to call him Leon Trollgoats, but that's it's not.
Not
that's McKinley. I can't remember the guy's name off the top of my head. Anyways, he is put in jail, and eventually he is deported back to Russia, because he is a radical Russian immigrant, okay, which just continues to feed this anti-radical immigrant fire in America.
We're gonna keep on talking about that.
And then guess what? On the day that he is being deported, Henry Frick dies.
And he's like, success.
And he does. He goes, well, at least I got to stay in America longer than Frick did. And then he's back to Russia.
Alexander Berkman.
Berkman.
All right.
Good story.
Keep it on. Pullman strike. Right. Last thing. Pullman strike. Another. This is what I've been trying to talk about this entire time, but it hadn't happened. Pullman strike. Pullman rail cars. George Pullman, he invented the sleeping car or the refrigerated car?
I know sleeping car.
Sleeping car.
I know he did a sleeping car.
So his little factory, his factory is building sleeping cars. He's created this town around the Pullman factory.
Called Pullman, Illinois.
Surprise, surprise. It's also called Pullman. And all the people that work in the factory live in Pullman. But one day, it doesn't say how much he cut wages, but he did, probably 10%, but he did cut wages, but he didn't lower any of the cost of living in the town that he basically created. And so everyone's like, well, this sucks. Mm-hmm. Not going to take any of this.
Strike. Now, just a little side note, the reason that he, and the reason we see with the Great Strike, the reason we see the wage decrease here is because there's a panic.
Right.
And it's a panic that's, again, caused by overspeculation, but also caused by a really unstable economy. Surprise. Largely at this point because of these new industrial factors. Mm-hmm. So they cut wages, and the people are like, I'm not going to continue to pay these same Pullman prices and not get paid enough by Pullman. Mm-hmm. Strike happens. The ARU, the American Railway Union, is the union that is led by Eugene Debs, in this case for Pullman. It's an industrial union, so everybody can join. And they strike, and they start tearing up it's very a la Great Strike of 77.
It's like the other railroad strikes.
Tearing stuff up, all of that good stuff, or bad stuff. I just mean like strike stuff. So they start pulling it all up, but nobody dies. It's just like burning things,
yeah.
Like ripping up rail cars and all that. And end of the story?
Eugene Debs goes to jail.
He goes to jail for violating the Sherman Antitrust Act. What you say?
Pardon?
So Eugene Debs, because he really organized this strike, stopped train cars from moving, and he stopped a federal mail car.
The mail.
He was carrying, like, postage. And so they called.
Not to worry about the Interstate Commerce Act.
Don't even worry about that.
Also a violation of that, but whatever.
So he calls, the company owner calls Grover Cleveland, El Presidente, and says, can you figure this out? And he sends out 2,000 troops.
Yep, shut it down.
To shut it down. Eugene Debs is arrested. He's placed in jail.
Becomes a socialist.
Starts reading some Karl Marx in there.
Runs for president as a socialist.
Mm-hmm. So
we will continuously come back to Eugene Debs.
If you haven't noticed, between Eugene Debs here, Edward Bellamy, Thorstein Veblen, we are seeing the rise of socialism in America, and it's because of industry and the treatment of employees, their workers. We start to really see that strong suit. Also, immigration patterns.
I was just going to say, and we really blame, when we start to get really aggressive against socialism, we blame the immigrants because it's Karl Marx who's writing this stuff, and he's not from America. Surprise, surprise. Mm-hmm. We blame them for bringing it over here and infiltrating our innocent American minds.
Innocent.
Okay.
Right. I think it's good. It's a lot. I know it's long, but this is a really big unit here. So
yeah.
It's not even over.
It's not over. We got one more chapter, and then we out.
Yeah, and then we're like basically done with the class. So
in the entirety of U.S. history.
Yeah. All right, guys.
So
enjoy yourselves.
That's
enjoy
it.
This.
Leaving you with some Luda.
All right, guys.
All right, bye, guys.
Have a good one.